HarperCollins presents My Favourite Bible Stories, written by Sarah Fletcher and read by Theo Solomon and Adelio Adedeo.
This Big Book. This big book tells the greatest story ever. It's all about God and us, but the story could be called God's Great Rescue. The story begins way, way back, and there are lots of people to find in the pages and lots of things that happen. So, are you ready to discover the story and have a good look? Well, let's get going and open the book. To the grown-ups, welcome to My Favourite Bible Stories. This audiobook is a storytelling journey through many much-loved Bible stories. It is written with fun, rhythm, and a splash of gentle rhyme to help bring these amazing stories to life for your young reader. The audiobook is a vibrant telling of the biblical stories and not a direct translation of scripture. It seeks to be true to the feel and message of biblical accounts, but there are scripture references throughout if you wish to explore the original narratives in a deeper way. With each story, there is something to think about with your little one, something to do together, and something your child can pray if they would like to. Our longing is that children will love listening to the stories and discover through them the rescuer. We hope that you and your little one love dipping into these stories together. From Kelly-Jade and Sarah. In the very beginning, from Genesis chapter 1 and 2.
In the very beginning, before anything hopped or squeaked on the earth, there was God. God looked at the emptiness all around and smiled. I know. It's time to make something wonderful. Ready, steady, go. Day one. First, God spoke into the deep, deep dark and said, light. Suddenly, with a flash and a spark, brilliant white blazed out bright. God laughed and said, it's a really good sight. I'll call the light day and the darkness night. Day two. God breathed in deep, closed his eyes, and then breathed out a little word. Sky. And there, in a thousand brush strokes of blue, the heavens were painted wide and high. Day three. God spoke with a low rumble in his voice, and rich brown soil tumbled into the land. With a splash of blue and a splish of green, salty sea crashed over the sand. Next, God had a think and began to plant greens, yellows, reds and pink. Flowers and trees sprung up from the ground like a sweet-smelling garden with fruit all around. Day four. Now it was time for something fun, something called moon and something called sun. God threw lights into space and time, leaving stars to sparkle and twinkle and shine. Day five. God looked at the earth and loved what he saw, but he still wanted to make some more. So, with a squawk and a flap and a swish and a splish, the earth was filled with birds and fish. Day six. With a fluff of fur and a pad of paw, with spots and stripes and patterns galore, with scuttle and stomp, boing, bounce and crawl, God made the animals big and small. Lastly, God took a handful of dust, saying, let's make friends just like us. He breathed his breath in the people made of clay, and they started to dance and laugh and play. He gave them his garden so they could have fun, and God's story with us had just begun. And on the seventh day, God had a rest.
Have a think. God is the great artist, He made an amazing world for us to share and look after. He made us so that we could enjoy being friends with him. Have a go. Can you paint a picture of our beautiful world? What kind of plants and animals will you have in your painting? Have a pray. Dear God, thank you that you made everything and you made me. You really are the greatest artist. Amen. A Big Bite from Genesis, chapters 2 and 3.
God made a man called Adam and a woman called Eve. God loved them and they were his friends. God gave them everything in his garden, except one thing. He said, "My friends, don't eat the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Trust me, if you eat it, you will die. Everything else is yours to try." Adam and Eve lived happily in the garden, close to God and close to each other. But then God's enemy, called the devil, came to ruin this perfect world. He took on the shape of a snake and slithered up to Eve, smirking. "Sss! Did God really say that you can't eat from any of these lovely trees? How mean." "Sss!" Eve said, "No, we can eat from all of them except one. If we eat it, we'll die." The sneaky snake hissed, "You won't die. God is telling you lies. He knows if you eat it, you will become very wise about good and evil. The fruit is really tasty. Why not have a bite?" "Sss!" The fruit did seem good. So Eve took a big bite. Munch, munch, crunch, crunch. The fruit was nice. The snake must have been right. Eve gave some to Adam, and he took a big bite. Munch, munch, crunch, crunch. The snake sniggered at the sight. As soon as they had eaten, they realised they were naked. Then they felt ashamed for what they had done and they tried to hide from God. God called out, "Adam, my friend, where are you?" Adam was afraid and stammered, "We're over here, hiding away." Then it all came out, how the snake had tricked them. And without a doubt, they had listened to the story he had spun. They had ignored what God, their friend, had told them, and the great separation had begun. Their friendship with God had been torn apart. They had to leave the garden, and God's heart was broken for the ones he loved. Now they would know what sadness was all about, for death and evil had been sown into the once perfect world. Yet God would never abandon those he had made, and he already had a plan through which everyone could be saved. He would send the rescuer to make the way, the rescuer who would right the wrongs, the rescuer who would save the day.
Have a think. Adam and Eve made a really bad choice in the garden. They chose to go their own way and ignore God. In that moment, friendship with God was broken, and pain and sadness came into the world. But God always loved people and was always planning a great rescue so everyone could be close to him again. Have a go. Tell your grown-up about a time when you have ignored a warning that someone who loves you has given. How does it affect things when you have chosen not to listen? Have a pray. Dear God, thank you that even though things looked really bad, you are always planning a great rescue for the world. Amen. Noah's Boat from Genesis chapters 6 to 9. Many years later, the people of Earth had turned against God and turned against each other. God was sad, because everyone was so full of hate. Everyone, that is, except Noah. So God was planning a great rescue where he would save Noah and make everything new. God said, "Noah, my friend, you need to build a really big boat So when the earth is flooded, your family and the animals will stay afloat. Noah began to build with a tap, 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 and a tat, 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 wood on wood and nail on nail. Soon, Noah's ark was ready to sail. Next, with a stomp and a scuttle, a hop and a flap, a snort, an oink, a baa, and a moo, all types of animals came to the ark and climbed on board, two by two. When Noah and his family were safe inside, God shut the big wooden door. And then the rain began to pour and pour. With a pitter-patter, clitter-clatter, plip, plop, plop, for 40 days and 40 nights the pelting rain just did not stop. The floodwaters rose right up to the sky, but all in the ark were safe and dry. A boat afloat on the flooded earth, it must have been quite a sight. But Noah trusted God to keep them safe. He fed the animals and sat tight. Until eventually, the rain stopped, and God started to blow the floodwaters away. Noah sent a dove to search for land, and it flew back carrying a leaf, for the trees were beginning to poke and peek above the waters high, and soon the land would all be dry. After many days and nights, the ark landed on a solid mound. Everyone came out of the boat and walked on dry ground. Hooray! Noah said, "Thank you, God, for keeping us safe. Help us to live close to you all of our days." God promised he would never flood the whole earth again, and he put the rainbow in the sky as a sign of peace and love divine. So, when you see the colourful bow with its red, orange, yellow, green, blue, violet, and indigo, remember that God loves us and will never leave us on our own. Have a think. God rescued Noah, his family, and the animals. He kept them safe and gave them a chance to start again. Have a go. Collect some pebbles or plastic bottle tops and paint each one as a different animal or as the different people in Noah's family. Get a small box and paint it like a boat. Now, put everyone safe and sound in the ark. Have a pray. Dear God, thank you that you love us and that you have promised to always be with us. Amen. A Sky Full of Stars. From Genesis, chapters 12, 15, and 21.
Years later, God spotted a man called Abraham and whispered to him, "Come on a great adventure with me." God promised he would give Abraham and his wife, Sarah, a place to call home. So they set out, not knowing where they were going, but knowing that the God who made everything was with them. Along the way, they became friends with God and got to know him. But Abraham and Sarah had a deep sadness in their hearts. They didn't have a baby, and they really wished they did. Abraham and Sarah got older and older, way too old to have a child. But one day God said, "Abraham, my friend, don't be afraid. I am the one who looks after you. I am your great treasure." Abraham sighed. "I know, God, but the thing I really desire is not possible. I don't have a child, and I'm now old." But God said, "You and Sarah will have a son. I promise." Then God took Abraham outside and whispered, "Look up at the stars and count them one by one." Abraham looked at a sky full of stars that glistened and glimmered and sparkled and shone. And he started to count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.